know that many famous singers started singing as little kids in church. So there's a great future here. So I have one question. It might seem an odd question to you, but the question is, why are you here? And I don't mean why are you here in church. What is your purpose in life? What is your mission in life? We don't often ask people, when we meet them, we don't often ask them, what is your mission? We usually say things like, what do you do? Where do you live? Where are you from? Where are your parents from? Most time we just say, hello, how are you? We move on. And I experimented with that. I was walking down the halls of a college campus, and someone would say hi, and I would say hello back. And he would say, how are you? And I'd say, terrible. They would say, wonderful, glad to hear it. Have a great day. We're not great listeners, are we? But what is your mission? I would challenge you today when you go home, after you've had your lunch, after you've had your lay activities, to take some paper and write out, what is God's mission for me? And if you want to spend some time in prayer and spend time in God's Word, wrestling with that question, Lord, what is your mission for me? What is that mission? And the reason I tell you to write it down, nothing happens unless you write it down. Then it has a better chance of becoming a reality. And I also challenge you to ask the Lord to expand your mission that you understand and to help you go beyond your comfort zone. Now last week we examined the book of Mark. And today we're going to stay in chapter 1, but we're going to be looking at verses 9 through the end of the chapter, or through 29. Wrestling with that question, why did Jesus come? What was his purpose? Now many would say, Jesus came to do what? Yes, he came to save us from our sins. What else did he come to do? Yes, and what else did he do? What was the last thing he did before he was resurrected? Before he was resurrected, what did he do? He died on the cross. So most people make the assumption that Jesus' mission was to come and to die on the cross. But Jesus didn't just come and then die, did he? He spent 3 years in ministry. And so we want to try to draw some lessons from that. So if you go back to verses 37 and 38 of chapter 1 of the book of Mark. Why did Jesus come? So Peter finds him alone and praying. And he says, everyone is looking for you. Jesus replied, let us go somewhere else to the nearby village so I can preach there also. That is what? That is what? That is why I have come. Let's review a few things we learned last week. Gospel of Mark begins with John the Baptist preaching the gospel, preparing people for the soon coming of Jesus as the Messiah. So he sends John into the wilderness. And John does not follow human prescription for drawing crowds. Otherwise, he would have lived in the cities. He would have lived in the comforts of the towns, and people would have come to his house or to his meeting place. But rather, God sent him into that dry, dangerous region known as the deserts or the wilderness. Secondly, John has a mission of preparing people for their need for a Savior. Thirdly, John doesn't just stop at declaring that we're sinners. We all know we're sinners, don't we? That's the bad news. We all know the bad news. But he's preaching the good news. Not that you're saved by your works, as the scribes and the Pharisees would preach, but although that we are sinners, we are saved by God's abundant grace. And he forgives us. He's more willing to forgive us than we are to ask for forgiveness. One of my favorite books, Steps to Christ, page 14, says, "Repentance such as this is beyond the reach of our own power to accomplish. It is obtained only through who? Only through Jesus." Page 26, the same book, "We can no more repent without the Spirit of Christ to awaken the conscience than we can be pardoned without mercy." That's great news, isn't it? God not only wants to forgive us, he gives us the gift of repentance. And John's message is such a stark contrast to the scribes and the Pharisees, who are saying, if you do these things, if you do X, Y, and Z, you have a chance of being okay with God. But some of you, because of your occupation or your lifestyle, you have no hope. John's message is, we all have hope. We all have that. And John says, "I am preparing you for the one who is greater than I, one who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Oh, bless us. Appreciate that. Bless us right there. So, John is telling us that Jesus not only will forgive us our sins, but that he will also transform us into his likeness, and we will become his perfect and holy bride. Isn't that wonderful news? Everybody's trying to be perfect. John is saying that Jesus is the answer to perfection. Now, verses 9 through 13, I actually should say 14 through 39, shows us two aspects of the mission of Jesus Christ. The first is teaching and preaching, which he does both in large crowds, small groups, and on one-on-one, and his acts of compassion, of healing and casting out demons. And then that chapter ends, that section ends, with Jesus going off alone to pray. So look first at Jesus' baptism. Join me in Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. Mark chapter 1, 9 through 11. "And it came about in these days." See if that water clears my frog. See if I can drown that frog. So, again, "It came about those days that Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, and he was baptized by John in the Jordan. And immediately, coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And a voice came out of heavens, 'You are my beloved Son, in you I am what?
Well
pleased.'" Why did Jesus ask John to baptize him? Was Jesus a sinner? So then why did he ask for baptism? He has to fulfill all righteousness. Why else?
Example.
Speak up, I can't hear you.
Example.
As an example, Jesus wanted us to know that he understands what it is to deal with human issues. So not only did he associate himself with humanity, but this was the beginning of his journey to the cross. When the Holy Spirit descends upon him, This is that act of anointing, much like the kings and prophets of the Old Testament. He was anointed. And then Jesus shares with us from Isaiah 61. It's found in Luke 4:19. He shares his mission. Luke 4:19. Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are downtrodden, and to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord." This is only one of the three times in Jesus' entire life that God speaks to him audibly. God is encouraging Jesus as he begins his ministry. Now, Matthew and Luke give us the details of Jesus' wilderness experience. Mark does not give us details of that wilderness experience, except he does tell us something that the other gospel writers do not tell us. He said that Jesus was with the wild animals. Now, the reason that Mark does this is because the readers of his gospel, the believers of Rome, were living at a time when Nero was the Caesar and he was throwing Christians into the arena and throwing them to wild animals. So that when they were baptized, they knew that they too would have a wilderness experience just as Jesus did. And that God would be them through those wilderness experiences. Verse 12. "And immediately," Mark's favorite word, "and immediately the Spirit impelled him to go out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beast, and the angels were ministering to him." So the Spirit impelled Jesus to go into the wilderness to be tempted. Why was Jesus tempted? I'm hard of hearing, so you don't have to speak up. Why was Jesus tempted?
He's a human flesh.
Because he's human flesh? Yes. Any other ideas?
How about because he was just baptized, and so many of us, when we're baptized, feel that we're beyond temptation.
Yeah,
and
it's
been part of the example that he gave us.
Yes.
Jesus is being tempted there and is able to resist.
Very well. Very well done. Turn to your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Those are both good answers, by the way. Turn your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 2 and 3. "Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands." So there's two things he says there that of why the Israelites are being tempted. Did you notice those two things?
"I'm going to test you."
To humble you and to test your heart. Verse 3 says, "He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you what man does not live on bread alone, but on the very word that comes from the mouth of the Lord." So the wilderness experience for the Israelites lasted how long?
40 years.
And how long did Jesus' wilderness experience last?
40 days.
40 days. And why did God send Jesus into the wilderness? It's right there in Deuteronomy. Chapter 8.
"Humble and test you, know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not."
Yes, to humble Jesus and to test his heart. to remind us that we must depend on the Word of God. At Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10 says that Jesus was perfect through suffering. Now, Matthew and Luke tell us that Satan tempted Jesus to use his power to meet his needs instead of depending upon his Father's grace. You ever had that temptation to try to depend on your own power rather than on God's power? Have you ever been tempted to skip your devotions or to have a quickie prayer and then try to fight the day's battles? That's what the devil is trying to tempt Jesus. Secondly, Satan tried to tempt Jesus to use his power to wow the people instead of teaching, serving, and loving them. And lastly, Satan was trying to tempt Jesus to become the king of the world without having to go through the cross. Aren't you glad that Jesus said no? He said no to the easy route. And he said yes to the cross. And Luke ends his account of Jesus' temptation with a rather interesting statement in verse 14 of chapter 4 of Luke. He says, when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Jesus was tempted all through those 40 days. And Mark suggests that Satan would continue to look for opportunities to tempt Jesus. And the opportunities would come frequently and quickly. Now, Jesus' ministry, you got John the Baptist, now you got Jesus. And Jesus' ministry begins at the end of John's ministry. As you know, he'll be put in prison and he'll be beheaded. Their two ministries were built on one principle, preaching the righteousness of salvation through God. Salvation by grace. But their ministries were radically different. John baptized with water, and what did Jesus baptize with? The Holy Spirit. John's message was to look for the coming Messiah. Jesus' message was, I am the Messiah. So let's look at Jesus' preaching ministry. Notice verse 14. And after John, Mark 1, verse 14, and after John had been taken into custody, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. Verse 16, and he was going along the Sea of Galilee, and he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net in the sea, for they were fishing. Now it's possible that the reason that Mark lists Peter as the first disciple is because Peter was his mentor. And he was writing the memoirs of Peter. And so we first meet Apostle Peter. And then verse 17, Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you what? Fishers of men. Now that phrase really comes from the Old Testament. If you hold there, flip back to Jeremiah 16. And verse 16, you'll find this reference that Jesus is taking to us. Jeremiah 16, 16. Behold, I will send for many fishers, says the Lord, and they will fish them. And afterwards I will send many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain, from every hill, and out of the holes of the rocks. You see, saying when Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men, this was not some clever advertising statement. Jeremiah 16 is a presentation of a judgment. Jesus takes the judgment upon himself for us.
men.
And Jesus is saying that the men and the women who are caught in the fishermen's nets and who welcome have to have a relationship with Jesus will not face judgment. Verse 18, and they immediately, here's Mark's favorite word, left their nets and followed him. And going a little further, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were also in the boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went away to follow him. And then they went to Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and began to preach, or began to teach. And they were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority, not as the scribes. In verse 22, there's one word that the people used that set Jesus apart from the scribes and the Pharisees. Did you see that word?
Authority.
Authority, yes. They saw in Jesus an authority that they did not see in the scribes and the Pharisees. And Mark, the word that Mark uses implies a supernatural authority. And it should not be surprised then that Mark is going to follow up this with a supernatural confrontation. Notice verse 23. And just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, What do we have to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. And Jesus rebuked him, saying, be quiet and come out of him. See, it appears that Jesus does not want the declaration that he is the Messiah to come from the lips of a demon. You remember later, Jesus would ask the disciples, who do men say that I am? And Peter is the one that finally gets the right answer. You are the Christ. So Jesus commands the demon to be muzzled. And the word he uses there in Mark, when he says be quiet, is the same term he uses on the Sea of Galilee in the midst of a storm when he says, peace, be still. Verse 26, and throwing him into convulsions, the unclean spirit cried out with a loud voice and came out of him. And they were all amazed. So they debated among themselves, saying, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. And immediately, the news about him went out everywhere into all surrounding district of Galilee. What was the purpose of Jesus' preaching? It's found in verse 17. What was the purpose of Jesus' teaching? The answer is in verse 17.
Follow me.
That's one of them. Follow me.
Become fishers
of men. Jesus came not to be a solo, but he came to train men and women to be fishers of men. There is a story told that when Jesus left planet Earth, after he spent time with the disciples and others, and he got to heaven, there was this wonderful, wonderful celebration. And one of the angels said to Jesus, Lord, we're ready to go down and finish the gospel. And Jesus said, no, I'm not sending you. And they said, what do you mean? Who's going to finish the work? And he said, the disciples. And the angel said, but Lord, they don't even like each other. How are they going to finish the gospel? He says, they'll trust me, and I'll give them the power. And they'll finish the gospel. Mm-hmm. Desire of Ages 142, God could have reached his object in saving sinners without our aid. But in order for us to develop a character like Christ, we must share his word. Isn't that amazing? The more we share the good news of the gospel, the more we become like Jesus. Good reason to share, isn't it? Now there are six characteristics of Jesus' teaching. Three are facts, two are responses, one's a quality. In verse 15, it tells us what Jesus is preaching. He says to believe what?
In the gospel.
To believe in the gospel. Believe in the good news, the good tidings. We are not helpless. We are not abandoned. We are not orphans. Believe the gospel. The good news that John the Baptist was preaching, that God's grace is abundant and he's more willing to forgive you than you are to ask. Secondly, also in verse 15, what is Jesus preaching? The very first thing he says in verse 15, the time is fulfilled. And what time is that? What time is fulfilled? If you whisper, I won't hear you. I still don't hear you. Speak up.
Arrival of the Messiah?
Yes, the time of the fulfillment. The prophecies that the Israelites were very aware of, the 2300-day prophecy, it's being fulfilled. They're seeing history in the making. The time is fulfilled. And what is being fulfilled? Genesis 3:15. God's plan to save mankind. A Savior. And Jesus is telling us he's that Savior. And that promise continues through Abraham, through Isaac, through Jacob, through Isaiah. The time that man had been looking forward to for centuries is fulfilled. And the law is fulfilled. Matthew 5:17, Christ fulfills the law. All of the promises of the sanctuary service, all of the imagery of the sanctuary service pointing toward, as John the Baptist said, the Lamb of God which will take away the sins of the world. Jesus is saying the time is fulfilled. He is fulfilling all that imagery. What they should have understood was when he said that, that he is the Lamb that ultimately to be slain. That he is our perfect high priest as well as our perfect offering. Jesus said he had come to fulfill the law, to fulfill the sanctuary service. Thirdly, what did he tell us? We've got the times fulfilled. We've got to believe the gospel. What's the third thing he tells us?
The kingdom of God is at hand.
The kingdom of God is at hand. And what? How do we say that today? We say Jesus is what? Coming soon. The kingdom of God is near, nearer than we expected. And then verse 22, the quality of Jesus, and said they were amazed at his teachings, for he was teaching them as one having authority, not as the scribes. Now when the scribes preached, they quoted different rabbis. Rabbi A believes this, Rabbi B believes this, Rabbi C believes this. You decide what you're going to believe. But Jesus quoted Old Testament scriptures. And why did he quote Old Testament scriptures? Why didn't he quote New Testament scriptures? There were no New Testament yet. But his power was the Word of God. And the people had not been hearing the Word of God. Now, In verse 23, Jesus deals with the demons. It's important to note that the casting out of this demon takes place while Jesus is teaching. The demon is trying to disrupt what Jesus is teaching. He's trying to close the ears of the people. He's trying to terrify people. And that's why